You're watching Reality Check. Over the past few weeks, Madhya Pradesh has witnessed a number of communal flare-ups as yatras, ostensibly to collect cash for the new Ram Mandir coming up in Ayodhya, have clashed with Muslims. The clashes have triggered conflicting claims. Hindu groups claim they were attacked and pelted with stones as they passed through Muslim areas, as seen in this video, for instance, from the town of Ujjain, where one can see stones being pelted from a rooftop on the yatra. But videos have also surfaced showing Hindutva mobs climbing on top of mosques, even attacking them again and again. What is worrying is that the response of the state government seems to be largely one-sided, demolishing the homes of those accused of pelting stones. And now the government has announced a law which extracts punitive costs from those pelting stones, similar to a controversial law passed by Uttar Pradesh. This despite existing laws having ample provisions to penalize wrongdoers. While it's been far less proactive in ensuring that these processions do not pass through sensitive areas or on cracking down on those who targeted mosques or raised provocative slogans. We zeroed in on each of these incidents for which we could get verified information to understand how the actions of the government seem to be driven less by ensuring even-handed justice, more by political vendetta. The first incident was on the 1st of December, on December 25th, I beg your pardon, in the Begum Bagh neighborhood of Ujjain, where clashes as Bharatiya Janata Yuva Morcha rallies passed through a Muslim-dominated neighborhood and where reportedly Jai Shri Ram slogans were raised. The police say that stone pelting on this yatra by Muslims led to a stampede-like situation. Muslim residents, on the other hand, claim that these Ram Mandir rallies were taken through the area on multiple occasions. A day after the rally, though, there was a demolition drive in the Muslim area, according to the administration, to clear illegal encroachments. 8 were arrested, all Muslims. There's been the National Security Act, the draconian NSA, against 4 of them. 4 more have been charged with rioting and attempt to murder. There's been an FIR against 1 member of a Hindu group. The second incident is spread across December 25th and 29th in a village in Mandsaur district. Here, a VHP-led Ram Mandir rally on the 25th claimed they were attacked by Muslims. There was a second Ram Mandir rally on the 29th, which went on to Gherao a mosque. Hindutva groups were seen in this video climbing atop the mosque, planting a saffron flag. This attack, despite Muslim locals seeking police protection a day earlier, warning that something like this could happen. 9 have been arrested by the police, their identities or their religious identities unclear. There's an offense against 49 others. The third incident is from December 29th again, from a village near Indore. Again, clashes as a Ram Mandir rally passed through a Muslim area. Conflicting versions of the clashes, Hindu groups claiming they were pelted with stones, Muslims saying the Hindus raised provocative chants outside the mosque. The Hindu group, though, returned in large numbers and, as this video shows, climbed onto a minaret in that particular village. And again, one can see there that the police van was parked right outside, and despite that, the mosque was targeted. 29 people have been arrested from both communities, but according to local reporters, most of those arrested are Muslims. Days after the clash, the government demolished at least 25 homes in the Muslim area. The government claimed that there was illegal encroachment, and that's why they carried out this demolition drive, that they needed to widen the road. Local officials told the media that the demolition was not in retaliation for the violence, and that locals in the Muslim areas had willingly offered their houses to be demolished.
Sir, जो मकान बाधक जो हटाए जा रहे हैं, सर उनके भी कुछ घर वालों को आरोपी बनाया गया सर?
अब ये पुलिस की कार्रवाई है, कौन आरोपी बने हैं, जिसने घटनाक्रम को अंजाम दिया है, मे बी कि उसमें भी कुछ लोग निश्चित रूप से होंगे, तो ये कार्रवाई अभी आइडेंटिफिकेशन की चल रही है और कुछ गिरफ्तारियां भी हुई हैं। तो ये जो कार्रवाई है ये तो अभी जारी रहेगी क्योंकि अज्ञात में भी मामले कायम हुए हैं।
एक सवाल और उठा, नोटिस दिए गए थे क्या उनको?
किन की?
जो डेमोलिशन की कार्रवाई है उसके लिए नोटिस जारी करने?
सहमति के आधार पर कार्रवाई हुई है।
इन द फाइनल इंसिडेंट इज फ्रॉम January 3rd, 2020, सो वेरी रीसेंट। दिस इज फ्रॉम राजगढ़ डिस्ट्रिक्ट। वंस अगेन हिंदुत्व ग्रुप्स अलाउड टू टेक आउट वन ऑफ दीज राम मंदिर रैलीज डिस्पाइट ऑल दीज प्रीवियस ग्रोइंग इंस्टेंसेस। Somewhere along the way, a large Hindutva mob gathered outside the local mosque and raised a number of provocative slogans. Again, we've taken out the audio because it's extremely inflammatory, but the visuals tell their own story. The police and local elders reportedly rushed to the spot and the mob was dispersed. No arrests have been made so far in this particular case. Okay, all right, let's go across to panel. At the moment, we have with us senior journalist Neerja Chaudhary and Shadan Farasat, advocate, Supreme Court. We'll be joined by more of our panelists very shortly. But let me just start with you, Shadan Farasat, that obviously no one is making the case, certainly not on this show, that stone pelting is something that should be permitted or there shouldn't be a crackdown on it. But if you see the overarching story that's emerging from Madhya Pradesh, both the way the police has acted in these instances and now with the law that the Shivraj Singh Chauhan government has brought, is there any substance to the sense that this is the state acting in a partisan manner, in a one-sided manner?
I think this shows two things. Firstly, that this is weaponization of So basically use the law in a partisan manner as a weapon to shut down one group of community. And second, which we lawyers sometimes call, show me the face and I'll show you the law. That is a selective application of the law. I mean, there is a law for everything, but it will be applied only vis-a-vis one face. For the other face or the other group, it will not be applied. And I think both these things are rather evident. This is quite obviously a one-sided application of the law, which is constitutionally not permissible. If there are two groups which are in the wrong, you determine the extent of whatever wrong has been done by each of the groups and appropriate action proportionate to whatever is the extent of their wrong, you take that.
Right.
Selective application has no no space in our constitutional and criminal jurisprudence, but that's what seems to be happening, both in terms of actual application on the ground and even this new supposed law which is being proposed, which is for fining, etc., for stone pelting.
Right. I wanted to ask you about this law because it's very similar to what the Uttar Pradesh government did in the aftermath of protests against the CA and NRC earlier, or towards the early part of last year, the latter part of 2019, where once again the argument made was this is not a law targeting any particular community, but the question arises, it's done in the same context, that the moment you have Muslim protesters who are out on the streets throwing stones, perhaps even damaging public property, you bring this law, and you also have existing laws under which you can penalize those who do that.
That's right. So the existing, there's a judgment of the Supreme Court, In Re Destruction of Public Property, which already envisages a mechanism, and that mechanism, the High Court has to appoint a retired judge of the High Court as a claims commissioner who will do some kind of an inquiry, will submit a report to the High Court, then the High Court will give an opportunity to whoever is the party which is supposed to have done wrong to be heard, and thereafter only penalty will be determined. It can't certainly be only an executive driven process, and the UP law also sought to do that, and that is pending challenge in Allahabad High Court. Certainly any kind of mechanism in only which the executive charges and the executive determines as to who is the wrongdoer will not withstand the constitutional scrutiny.
Right. You know, what is interesting, Neerja Chaudhary, is that all of this is happening in Madhya Pradesh under Shivraj Singh Chauhan's watch. He's by and large been seen, at least until now, as one of the more moderate leaders of the BJP, who's always tried to have this kind of wide appeal. But now there seems to be an increasingly strident tone. Before this, we saw him very much lead this charge of BJP states passing laws against so-called love jihad. Then he made that very provocative and uncharacteristic comment where he said, I'm in a dangerous mood. Anyone who takes me on, I'll bury them 10 feet under. And now he, in a way, with bringing this law against, the pelting of stones, he seems to be endorsing the heavy-handed, somewhat one-sided approach by his police and administration.
Yes, you know, when you were reading out all the different instances, that's the first thing that came to my mind. Under Shivraj Chauhan, this is happening. And that is the disappointing part of the story, because he has navigated very difficult situations in the past. And of course, he's been a moderate, and maybe because he's been a moderate, and that's a charge that many in his party make against him, that he now feels the need and the pressure not to be moderate and to show that he is towing the traditional party line. That's point number one. Point number two, I would say, you know, it seems to me stone pelting, for stone pelting, you bring NIA. For stone pelting, you attach property. Apart from it being used selectively against the minority community to cow them down, obviously, it is like swatting a fly with an AK-47. And why are you doing that? What is the compulsion to do that? Even it is incomprehensible, even in political terms, apart from it being, you know, you don't understand it, and it's so sectarian, so partisan.
It almost seems to be the yogi model, because much has been made of how increasingly BJP chief ministers are following the yogi model. UP takes the lead on laws of this kind, even on the so-called love jihad laws, and now other states are falling into place, including moderate figures within the BJP like Shivraj.
You know, I think we, again, something that comes to my mind, I think this whole situation needs to be looked at much more in detail. What are the kind of things happening on the ground? Is stone pelting taking place?
Yes.
What is actually, you know, as we are looking at love jihad, okay, so many cases have happened in UP, 14, out of which only two girls made the charge.
Yes.
The rest were all blood relatives. How many people are arrested? We need to know on the ground what is happening. Whether it's an all media delegation that goes, different media representatives, whether it's different party delegation that goes and studies it, I think it really needs a closer look. What really is going on.
Right. But again, Shadhan, you know, this is all, some would say, at the level of abstract debate. We can sit here and debate about all of this, and we can talk about how, you know, whether this is one-sided and unfair. But on the ground, there is a certain impunity with which these laws are being passed, the way the police and administration is acting. What's the way around that?
Yeah, no, I think that's very true, that, I mean, principles of constitution are only as good as they are applied. And I think that's where it's important that in matters like this, be it, you know, prima facie unconstitutional ordinances such as the UP one, or such proposed laws as what the MP government is proposing, they're tested very quickly within a matter of days and weeks, and an outcome comes relatively quickly. Because if you just let it linger in the courts, that gives too much time for the executive agencies, if they are prejudiced in a certain way, to work out their prejudice on the ground. And really, the constitution is the silent spectator being mutilated. And that's not what is envisaged. So it's important that the courts step in quickly in time and come to decisions within a very, very, you know, time-bound manner, especially in egregious cases such as these.
Right. Also joining us on the show, we have Lalita Kumar Mangalam, Director India Foundation, member of the BJP, and also Jayavardhan Singh of the Congress. He's been a former minister in the Madhya Pradesh government. Lalita Kumar Mangalam, the point we're making is that when you have a state like Madhya Pradesh particularly, you have Shivraj Singh Chauhan largely seen as a moderate leader. And then when you see these yatras going through the state, clearly they're provoking and creating communal tensions. Why is the action one-sided, only against the minority community for targeting these yatras? There's no similar crackdown on the majority community for taking out these yatras, for targeting mosques, for chanting provocative slogans.
Vasu, first of all, thank you for allowing me to join so late. I'm sorry, I was on the way home and I got held up. Secondly, I don't think Madhya Pradesh government is intending to target any particular community. And I don't think it's fair to say that Hindus cannot take out yatras. If they are chanting provocative slogans, then yes, the state should take action. What action they can and could take under the Constitution, I don't know.
But they're not.
And nor do I want to comment on what they should. But I'm sorry, I didn't hear the first part of the thing. I was told this discussion is about stone pelters. Well, stone pelters, regardless of what religion they may belong to, end up hurting a lot of other people too. And that should not be allowed. Against the minority community, I don't think that's entirely true at all.
No, the point here is that, and I said this at the outset, that, you know, no one is condoning pelting of stones. It's about the one-sided nature of the action of the state government, which is clearly targeted much more towards the minority community. And when you said if these yatras are being provocative, they should be stopped or there should be action against them, the whole point is they're not. It's been almost now over 10 days of these yatras, and they continue.
No, Vasu, I don't see how you can say that when Hindus take out Rath Yatras or a religious yatra, that it's provocative. I don't understand why people from other communities should object to it.
I'm not making a sweeping generalization that Hindus can't take out Rath Yatras, God forbid. I'm simply saying in this particular instance, there has been examples again and again of how these yatras taken out supposedly to collect donations for the Ram Mandir have triggered communal provocations. You've seen videos of, you know, people climbing onto mosques and whatnot. In that context, the state government could be as proactive when it comes to ensuring that there's no breach of law and order as it is doing with the other side. That's the problem.
Vasu, I think again that you are overstating the case. If there has been communal tension generally around the Ram Mandir issue, you know the reasons behind it, both historically and particularly over the last since 1992 when the Babri Masjid was brought down. But that is a different issue altogether. Here, if you feel that the state government is being unfair, then yes, anybody has a right to raise their voice and say that the state government should take equal punitive action against such people, regardless of what religion they may come from.
Okay, Jayavardhan saying...
Just one extra point I want to make. In the state where I come from, Tamil Nadu, we have a Christian church called Velangani, where Hindus go, Christians go, everybody goes. Yes. And they have huge, we don't call them Rath Yatras in Tamil, you know that. They have these huge processions which are akin to it. Nobody takes any objection, any objection.
No, but
sometimes there are problems. Sometimes problems flare up during these things or during when we have our Ganesh Chaturthi celebrations. Their problems do arise.
No, but this is not, as I said, this is not about religious processions per se.
Everybody should be treated
equally. This is not about religious processions per se. This is about the very specific context of what is happening in Madhya Pradesh. But coming to you, Jayavardhan Singh, we are not seeing any strong pushback from the Congress against any of this.
That's not true, sir. In fact, when this first incident happened, was in Ujjain.
Yes.
And in that case as well, it happened at the same time when in the country we weren't having parliament. In Madhya Pradesh, we didn't have Vidhan Sabha because of COVID.
Yes.
And it's, you know, totally bizarre that at such a time, the BJP government is letting these, processions take place in the state. You know, Jain, in Indore, in Mansoor it's happened.
Hmm.
It's happened in Rajgarh today.
Hmm.
So in a way, it's, quite shocking as to what's going on. And the day the violence happened in Ujjain on the first the first instance, we immediately, within a couple of days, we went to the chief secretary, went to the DGP and, conveyed this to them that this is not the way it's going to happen. If you're going to only, file a case on party, whereas
what did the official say to you when you went and
they've assured us that they'll take up strict action against both the parties and we've given them a time limit for this as well.
Okay,
but as of now there's nothing serious which they've done. And of course after Ujjain, when it occurred in in Indore, it happened in Mandsaur, and then across other cities as well. It clearly shows that, you know, Shivraj Singh Chauhan ji, in his first three terms, never had these kind of issues. But there's something different with him this time. I don't know whether he's lost control of what's the issue with him?
We will get a chance to put that to Lalita Kumaramangalam. But yes, Shahdan Farasis, you wanted to come in quickly.
Yeah, I just want to make the point that, you see, of course, every religious group is entitled to carry out the procession, but context is important. Now, Lalita ji said in Tamil Nadu, you know, one community passes through others. So the context, there is a history of things, it works out. But when you go in a particular community's area and chant religious slogan, which will obviously be provocative. The idea, the context is to provoke. And that's where the problem is. And that's where the administration has to prevent such things. Whichever community, if you allow for collection and into, you know, another community's residential area, which is predominantly of another community, it will be seen as provocative. It may happen once, twice, thrice. After that, there is a real chance of some
aggression.
And the administration has to avoid that.
Okay.
And in MP, the administration does not seem to be avoiding it. That's the point.
Okay. Lalita ji, yes.
I'm sure that everybody on this show and many people who are watching it are aware of the fact that we have a major industrial area in New Delhi called Okhla. Every Friday, the road there is blocked in the afternoons, 12 p.m. onwards, because a huge congregation of Muslims is doing their namaz. Now, that can also be called provocative, because first of all, you're not supposed to do it on the road, and they have a masjid nearby there. But there are no problems that are caused there. It's not as if, you know, forget about who's passing by in the car. Regardless of who may be in the car or in a bus or, you know, any transport that's flowing through that particular road, they are stopped, and it's extremely inconvenient. It is very provocative too. So it's unfair to say that only when Hindus chant slogans,
but who is saying that?
Other communities, the gentleman who just spoke before me, it's
no,
not about the slogans. It's also about, if you're talking about the action the state government should take, that yes, they should take equal actions against everybody. Regardless
no one
of
is
whether
saying,
they are, you know, stone pelters.
No
or not.
One is saying that
but
only
to say
Hindu,
that when Hindus take out
only,
their religious
no one
processions
is saying
and
that.
Chant religious
nobody
slogans,
is saying that.
Therefore,
nobody,
other people
but the thing
get,
is, you're
provocative to them.
You're
well,
questioning
that's,
something.
I don't think that's fair.
You're questioning something which literally nobody is saying. The point here is that in this particular context, it so happens that with these particular processions in Madhya Pradesh in this past 10 days, there have been repeated communal clashes. That doesn't mean that this applies to all Hindu processions that are ever taken out or all Muslim processions that are ever taken out. It's a very context-specific thing where you have multiple clashes.
Then I think
and
what
yet
we
the
need
processions
do
continue without any checks and balances, without any serious action against one side, mostly on the other. It's a very specific problem we're talking about. But I just want to come back to Neerja Chaudhary.
Like my younger Congress colleague just said, then they have, if they have given a memorandum or a protest letter to the government of Madhya Pradesh, I'm sure that they will take action.
Okay, Neerja Chaudhary, the thing is that this point we come back to about why this is happening this time around in Shivraj Singh's watch, because, you know, he's just managed to consolidate himself quite successfully after the by-elections. The numbers are very much in the BJP's favor. You know, the Congress again appears to be on the retreat. Elections are now years away. And yet this, what do you make of it?
I would say, as I was saying earlier, obviously it is pressure from within than from without.
Right.
And otherwise, it is incomprehensible. As you say, elections are not there. The party has the numbers, has the comfort level. The opposition
right.
also is not in such a, you know, great form, having lost the government. So why does he have to do it unless there is internal pressure?
Right.
And because he's been accused often enough, he's too moderate.
Yes.
So he's got to prove that he's not too moderate. I can't think of any other reason.
It could just be a product of the particular mode, the times that the BJP is in. But last word, Shahdan Farasis, so you're saying that one option is, of course, legal challenges, but that take time. We are still waiting to see what happens to the challenges against the so-called love jihad laws. So So in a sense, then, till those challenges start to fructify, this could continue.
Yes, I think that's also important that, you know, trial courts, magistrate courts, I mean, there are powers under CRPC to balance out the wrongful exercise of power by the police.
Right.
And one can just hope, as a lawyer, certainly I hope that those even lower courts and magistrates who have been given that power under the statute exercise it and correct, even in short span of time, these one-sided actions and ask the police to actually do a balanced act, which is what they're required to do.
Okay. Well, let's see if that happens. And let's hope that the cycle of communal tension in Madhya Pradesh is drawing to a close. Thank you all so much for joining us on Reality Check. Thank you so much for watching. We're out of time. Good night.